I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Mrs. Mayor, if you would do the roll call, please.
Absolutely. Tim Menneker.
Here.
Lisa Collins.
Here.
Gary Dunlap.
Here.
Tom Cruise.
Here.
Alex Zachary.
Here.
Cheryl Hancock.
Here.
Anita Shakosinski.
Here.
I love saying your name, by the way. And me, Kate Mayer. I'm here.
Okay, thank you. With seven of the seven school board members present, I would declare a quorum. Board norms reflection, you have a copy of the board norms in your folder. Just ask you to take a minute to look at those as we proceed with our agenda this evening. Approval of the agenda. I would note that the agenda has been published, posted and distributed and sent to the local media. With this in mind, are there any changes to the agenda? Seeing none, I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda as published.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any discussion? Okay, all those in favor of approving the motion to approve the agenda as published, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Motion carries. Public participation. Is there anyone who wishes to address the board relative to any item at this time? We ask that a 5-minute time limit per person be followed. Please come forward, state your name, address, and topic to be addressed. Good evening.
Good evening. I'm Todd Troutman. I am here tonight to remind you all that the Holmen High School band parent group has been actively working on a wonderful professional group that's coming to the high school this coming Sunday evening. Billy McGiggins is rock legends, and he'll perform at 7:30 at the high school auditorium. We're hoping that all of you will support the band and be there with your families and friends, as well as the rest of the community will be interested in being there as well. This performer is a professional group that is coming and being supporting our band in the venture for raising uniforms and such funds for that. So I have tickets with me tonight. There's tickets at the high school office as well as at festival food. So we look forward to seeing you. It is after the Packer game on Sunday afternoon. So you can come and celebrate a good concert as well.
How much are tickets, Todd?
Tickets are $20 a piece. This is the same concert professional that's going to be performing Saturday night at Viterbo, a different concert, the Buddy Holly concert, I think, is it Saturday night. And then he's staying overnight in town and performing for us on Sunday. So we're lucky to have him, and I look forward to a great concert.
And Todd, is it reserved seating or is it general admission? And
it is general admission. Okay. First come, pick your own place to sit.
Place to sit, okay. And then just for the record, could you state your address too?
Sure, N5906 Park Drive in Alaska.
All right, thank you. Thank you very much.
I just have a question. If I can't come, but if I wanted to get tickets for somebody, could I just buy some tickets and you would find somebody?
Absolutely.
To give them to?
Sure, that would be wonderful.
That would work?
That would work, yep.
How much time do I have to do that?
How much time do you have to do that?
Yeah, like how many days? Like, can I do it tonight? Do I need to do it tonight? Or
I have tickets tonight, but if you wanted to, you know, stop at the high school in the morning or by Wednesday probably, that would be fine.
I'll slip out and maybe find you before you leave then.
Okay, wonderful.
Thank you very much, Todd.
Is there anyone else who would like to address the board at this time? Okay, seeing no one else come forward, then I will move on to recognition and thank you. Dr. Carlson.
Yes, we have one recognition this evening. We would like to thank CenturyLink for their recent $5,000 grant donation, which will be used to fund the purchase of mobile devices specific at fifth grade for Viking Elementary. And so again, thank you to CenturyLink for providing this grant opportunity.
That is wonderful. Thank you, CenturyLink. Very generous contribution or grant. And thank you. I'm sure staff at Viking had to work to secure that as well. So thank you for going the extra mile and securing that grant. And then it's time for the visit with Senator Jennifer Schilling. Jennifer, you come forward. This is our annual visit with Senator Schilling, and we really appreciate your being here this evening with us.
Thank you.
And congratulations on your election for a minority leadership position.
Thank you. Well, happy new year, and it's been exciting. I've had a full week in the official role, but several weeks kind of leading up to that, and so really honored to have the confidence of my colleagues and working across the aisle where we can and find some common ground with the majority leader. We've had some good conversations already, myself with the majority leader and our staff meetings, and just kind of some of the things that you can't really see, but behind the scenes of just operation of sort of quality of life of the Senate, and we'll be working on that. But now the balloons are gone, the banners are gone, now the real work begins. But certainly last Monday was inauguration, and a very special day for families to be down there with their loved ones who were sworn in. And it's all about kind of those pancake breakfasts and potlucks and parades that you all get to, all that work that you do to get to that building and to be in that chamber. And a good special day, but certainly out of the box then we have our challenges before us, and legislation's already coming up and will be introduced, and hearings will be happening this week on things that certainly will be of keen interest to you. And I certainly want to thank you for the invitation. I think it's really important. There are several different school boards that I visit with, and so I think that this is really good communication on things that are happening in Madison, and getting feedback and also sort of ideas and things that are happening within the school district here that I can put on my radar and brag about when I'm down in Madison and talking about things, and some of the innovative good partnerships and collaboration that happen here in the Cooley region, which is one of the things when I became the leader, I wanted to talk about and bring that Cooley region common sense down to the Capitol and working with my colleagues. So we will hope to do that in the next couple years and things. Certainly we are off to a busy start, as you are probably all well aware of what's coming later this week, that the first bill out of the blocks within the assembly has been the school accountability bill. So I will talk about that, but also kind of bigger themes. The budget will be unveiled or presented to the legislature in February, and tomorrow we have the State of the State address. And so kind of that first teaser, I guess, of kind of what the governor's themes will be going into the budget address on February 3rd. If you think that the State of the State is early, it is. It generally is probably the last Tuesday of the month in January, but the governor has identified sort of an accelerated time frame that he is on. I think he's got some other things on the horizon that he's dipping his toe in the presidential pool to see if he's interested in that. And so this is sort of a little earlier than normal, and the budget address is a little bit earlier than normal as well. But one of the first things out of the block, like I had said, was the Republican school accountability legislation, that there will be a hearing held on that on Wednesday already in the Assembly Education Committee. Representative Thiensfeld introduced Assembly Bill 1 to provide exemptions to voucher schools while creating a process really for an unelected, unaccountable state board to take over the control of our local public schools. And as you delve into the legislation, the board that is going to be created, that they're at first blush, you look at it, I look at it, and I'm concerned about local control and taking away local control from our duly elected school boards across the state. Also looking at the option that the voucher schools can take one of four tests. I believe it's four tests that they have can choose from. So again, not really those same test scores to be compared between students across the state. Whereas the public schools will be required to take a certain test, and the voucher schools can once again kind of choose the test that they want. I'm also concerned because really from a standpoint that this is a very punitive bill. It is a punitive bill that doesn't really offer incentives for improvements. It's a punitive bill if the schools, and I will quickly find an article that was today in the Journal Sentinel that kind of talks about the areas of, and I'm just trying to, I have too much paper here. In the Senate, we're paperless, but when I'm back home, I'm totally married to my computer and my printer, and I like to have all my things before me. So just hold on one second. The Assembly Bill that will be up for debate, and it's interesting that I think that the Assembly and the Senate are not necessarily on the same page when it comes to this so-called accountability bill. The Assembly author, I think, sort of went ahead, introduced this without a lot of conversation and dialogue with school administrators and teachers and DPI, whereas on the Senate side, when something gets introduced by Senator Farrow, I think you will see something where Senator Farrow has been working with DPI, has been meeting with administrators and teachers throughout the summer and fall, and while there might be areas that they are disagreements, I think he listened to some of those folks who are those professionals in their craft. But what's on the table right now is that the Assembly bill calls for a new state board that is attached to the Department of Public Instruction of members that are appointed to a four-year term. The state superintendent plus six nominees, which would be a public school principal, a college or university of Wisconsin system representative, a charter school staffer, a private voucher school administrator, a voucher school teacher, and a technical college representative. Then the governor will have two nominees, an at-large member and a private college or university representative, one nominee from the Speaker of the Assembly, one nominee from the Senate Majority Leader, a nominee from the Assembly Minority Leader, who would have to be a charter school principal, and one nominee from the Senate Minority Leader's office, so our office, it would have to be a public school teacher. The bill would change the current five-tiered rating system of schools on the state report card to an A through F rating, which that area has some areas of concern about what that really means. With those letter grades that would be assigned to them, and schools with three straight years of D or F grades would have to comply with the improvement plan for at least 4 years. If they did not improve after 4 years, they could be shut down either by being converted to a charter school in the case of a public school, and having their taxpayer funding cut off in the case of a private voucher school, or having their independent charter revoked. I think it is troubling going down this path first thing out of the block. I know that last session the two houses were not able to come together. We all want a strong education system for our children. I am the mother of a fourth grader and a kindergartner. I am in public schools as a parent weekly. I am in public schools monthly in my role as a senator representing the 32nd. I am in urban schools, I'm in rural schools, I'm in the suburban schools. I don't think any of us in the Senate, if you would say who has those, and I hate to call them failing schools, I hate to put that label on them, but none of us are going to raise our hands and say, yep, we represent those schools. But I think there are better ways to look at some of the improvement that can be made, some of the investments that can be made, and really between some of the new things that have come on to the educator's plate for professional development and for the smarter balance. I mean, there are a lot of things that have come down the pike that we have really put a lot of expectation with our administrators, in our classroom, with our students, and with our teachers. And I think going down this path right now is just not the right direction for public education in this state. And I will be curious to see how things kind of play out in the Senate with a proposal that Senator Farrow will be introducing shortly. So that's kind of the first thing that in the Assembly they will be taking up. It was just introduced last week, and they already have a hearing on it on Wednesday. So really put some fast track going on there. I hope to be meeting with the Department of Public Instruction, if not with Tony Evers, with his staff, to kind of go through what some of these intended or unintended consequences are of this accountability bill. And if it really, I don't think from the standpoint of our party has introduced what we find is what we call really an accountability bill when it talks about the mechanics of a voucher school. This bill that the Republicans are putting forward for debate tomorrow or Wednesday, I don't think looks at sort of that level, the playing field and the mechanics of the voucher schools. And the bill that we have is much more comprehensive. I think it's got 12 to 15 areas areas that we are looking at to have those voucher schools be compared with the public schools, and if it's with teacher with the professional teacher background, if it's with school safety, there are many areas that we are looking at that the bill that Republicans have put forward in the Assembly really does not touch upon. So I think from your standpoint as school board members, that that certainly is one that should be on your radar, and feel free to weigh in with legislators, not just myself, but in the region, about what your thoughts are on this. But again, the local control and the punitive measures really are ones that I find troubling. So I'll kind of go through my update, and I'm happy to then kind of do some questions and have a discussion there. So the bill that the Dem voucher, or that the Democrats have put forward, is led by Senator Harris Dodd and Representative Pope, who has been on the Education Committee for a long time in the Assembly. And we really want to increase that accountability. We want to strengthen academic standards, and we want to stop fraud in the taxpayer-funded voucher program to prevent the failings in the first place. And I have seen headlines of schools that have closed in the middle of the night in the Milwaukee area who have taken millions of dollars from the state, and we have not been able to have sort of that clawback to have that money returned to the taxpayers. So we need to make sure that we have that we stop kind of that middle of the night departure of these school closings. And we want to make sure that children in Wisconsin really have an opportunity to a great education. And the majority of students in this state attend a public school in their community. I think as we go ahead into the budget, we will see, depending on sort of what the financial outlook is, we have a $2.2 billion structural deficit that we're grappling with. But I would not be surprised. We've seen that they would like to lift the caps on vouchers here in the state, and financially, if the governor and the majority party has the means to do that, we will see. But right now, it is doing some financial gymnastics, I guess, with a deficit in the transportation budget, the university system with a robust ask going into this budget. Department of Public Instruction, Tony Evers, with his funding formula changes, that those are all big asks of the budget. And we will know more what the governor wants to pick up from those recommendations from those agencies. I know that before tonight that you had forwarded some questions to me about things that were that we've dealt with in the past, and just sort of big pictures where I think we're going in this budget or in this legislative session. One of the first questions was the school year calendar, if there's going to be progress made in providing some local school districts more control over setting their calendar. And I think right now it really is unclear whether the Republican majority will be open to giving local school districts more flexibility in setting their school calendar. Right now, both leaders in both the Senate and the Assembly seem to be focused really on that school accountability bill, on the voucher bill. So we will kind of see what happens there. I got the feeling last session, I think it was Representative Ott and Senator Alberta Darling had put forward, I think, the school calendar bill, and maybe a means of sort of placating a little bit to the education system about some of the things that had happened in the past and some of the policies that had been put forward. It wasn't that calendar bill isn't really one that has a lot of fiscal associated with it. It's really more about flexibility for local districts. And I know, I think in the last session we had a bill that allowed some time changes, adding on minutes to the school day to kind of look at that 180-day versus that 180-day requirement. So I think we've moved toward the direction of loosening it up a little bit. We'll see what we actually do with the school calendar as we move ahead. You'd asked about the expansion of vouchers and what a potential expansion would look like and the impact that it would have on school districts. And it's clear that Governor Walker and the Republican leaders have talked about wanting to lift that cap on the voucher program. And if the cap were, you know, completely lifted, it could cost taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars and really have a very significant impact on our local school districts, that we are not meeting the need of our public schools now. And now to sort of open it up with a second parallel school system in the state, that is, I think, will continue to put a strain on the budget. And then thirdly, there was a third question that was asked about school districts across the nation had experienced an influx of illegal immigrant students and how are school districts chosen, and what is the potential impact on school funding for a local school district in Wisconsin. And that really is an issue that we haven't heard a lot about at the state capitol, maybe more of a federal issue, but I certainly will kind of keep my ears open to that as I am meeting with folks in the office about their agenda and what their spending, their priorities are as we get into the next session. So I will keep my eyes and ears open on that one. Before the Christmas break, I did have the opportunity in La Crosse to meet with the School Administration Alliance, and they shared with me their legislative agenda, which a lot of things that I could, you know, come right out and say I definitely supported that. But as we look at school reforms, really the emphasis on evidence-based best practices, I think, is really key and important, rather than basing some of our education requirements on ideology. And I am not, I don't have a background in education or early childhood development. I think many of us in the Assembly and the Senate do not have that. That I totally respect the professionals that are at DPI, that are within our schools across the state, and working with them and in coordination with policymakers for best practices and evidence-based ideas, I think, are important. Just briefly, they talked about some early learning opportunities, children's mental health. That's one area I hope we can continue to build on. In the last session, we passed a $30 million mental health package, and that really is just a drop in the bucket for mental health issues across the state. If it's for young people, if it's for veterans, if it's for people in corrections and in the judicial system. So I hope we can build on that. And I know in the Assembly they have a standing committee on mental health, so I hope that we can take a look at that and the school-linked mental health grant programs that were modeled after some successful Minnesota programs. So we'll be looking at that. Always a more sustainable school finance system, that's one that we need to continue to look at, as well as special education categorical aid, the high cost special education, transportation aid, and English language learners. So I think it was a pretty, it was kind of a positive offensive kind of ask of many of these ideas. We know that many of the ideas in public education, we're going to have to be on the defensive. If it's the school vouchers, if it's special needs scholarship for voucher schools as well. So some of these things will be kind of recycled ideas from last session, but now with the majority, I think even more conservative in both the Assembly and the Senate, that some of those moderate voices, I know at least in our House and the Senate, are no longer there with Senator Ellis and Senator Schultz, and certainly hope that working with Senator Luther Olson, we'll see if his party wants to go through him and his committee or around him in referring some of the education and education reform bills to different committees. So with that, I'm happy to take questions, but certainly we were kind of on the eve of kicking off our legislative session, and Tuesdays is typically the day in the Senate that we are in. We will see the school, or with the state of the state address tomorrow, which is sort of some highlights or some early themes to the governor's budget, but not serving on the budget committee this year on the finance committee. I will still be involved with the two members that I have appointed on our caucus to be there, and we'll be following it as it kind of gets into your DNA after you've served on the budget committee for three different budgets. You kind of follow it from afar, even if you're not on the committee. So with that, I certainly want to say thank you very much for everything that Holmen, that you are doing in the school district here. I hear so many positive things from families and students who really appreciate the education and the professionals that are in our schools day in and day out. And just reminded myself that as I was here many years ago, Brianna Schwabenauer, who had been one of your student representatives, is also going to be an intern in my office coming up. So it's kind of exciting to see those Holmen alumni are out there changing the world and getting involved, and she's doing so many exciting things down at Madison that we're really excited to have her talent in the office as she continues to kind of learn some public policy ideas and the implementation of that. So kudos to the great foundation that you are giving to our students across the region.
Great, thank you. Questions, any questions? Individual questions?
Yeah, too? I've got a few. I'm gonna try to keep my composure, but I am livid with much of what you have to deal with and we have to deal with as school board members. So I'm going to the Wednesday hearing that I'm going to try to get to talk to legislators and let them know that as a school board person, I can vote for what my school board needs. My public has elected me. They have not elected this committee. So there's one thing that makes me livid. Another thing is what they're proposing to substitute for me as a school board member is a committee. And of this committee, I believe there are six people on the committee, seven. One of them is a public school education person. And I think that's a principal.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think there's any teacher who's there. I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. That makes me livid. The money that's going away from my kids, if a school is failing, as I understand it, money goes first to private schools that have been given that honor of taking over for a failed school system. That comes on first. Therefore, my public school has that much less money. That makes me livid. I feel like Dr. Martin Luther King keeps repeating. But I'm just, there's so many things. School board rights. We are the tiniest of public officials. The tiniest. But I think also the ones that moms and dads appreciate the most. And these initial things that are coming up with this new idea are taking all of that local control away. And I am just, I'll be done soon, Cheryl, because I know I can go on and you need to tell me when to stop. However, the very people who argue for local control in many things are taking away local control. And I don't understand that. I don't get the irony. I don't know what the point is. The only thing I can see is it benefits private schools. It benefits private people who are going to make a school. So that's just me talking, Jen. And I don't know how those of us who feel this way can even be with you. Schultz and Olson have come out and spoken against this, but it doesn't matter really at this point.
Systematic, I mean, I see it as a systematic privatization of our public schools. And even listening to some of our colleagues referring to them, not even as public schools anymore, but government-funded schools. And that sort of negative connotation that it gets into folks. And I am proud of the public schools that we have here in Western Wisconsin. I am proud of the public school system overall in this state. Now, I know the Milwaukee public school system, I mean, that is sort of a different beast in that we need to address some of the shortcomings and achievement. I mean, we have achievement gaps throughout the state, not just in Milwaukee. But I guess for my colleagues to call this an accountability bill, it's not. They've also said, well, it's a school improvement review, you know, bill. The mechanics that I'm concerned about is making sure that the private voucher schools hire licensed teachers and conduct background staff. I'm concerned that they follow open records laws, that they meet graduation standards, that they conduct annual building inspections, that they even be located in the state. None of that is included in that bill that is moving forward on Wednesday. So we will see kind of what the two houses want to do between the Senate and the Assembly, because I think Senator Farrow's bill will be different. I don't know how different, if it is sort of that makeup. The one thing that I think we have seen in the days that this bill has been introduced, it sort of has fired up everyone, regardless of where you are. Even some really ultra-conservatives don't like it. Obviously, folks at DPI have some concerns. Democrats were not supportive of it. School administrators, teachers are concerned about it. I mean, sort of, it seems like they've introduced something that really no one is happy with. So we'll see where they go with that.
Thanks. Other questions? Any questions?
I guess.
Tim?
I'm sorry.
I'm working my way down.
Okay. I have a couple of comments, if that's okay. Certainly, thank you for coming. I know how busy your schedule is now, especially in your leadership position. So congratulations.
Thank you.
And really, I guess this is more of a comment that hopefully, you know, I'm looking forward to you in that position to bring some real change to Madison, not just in the ideas, which I know is very difficult in the minority party, but to the way business is being conducted in Madison. You know, recently, I think the Senate lost a good person in Senator Cullen, who recently retired from that. Several years ago when Act 10 was being passed, I was certainly in opposition to that at that time, still am, and unsolicited support of you in that recall election. I was disappointed, though, right after, not with you, but with the majority party when the Democrats temporarily got majority of the Senate in their treatment of Senator Cullen right after that. And I thought that was a little bit discouraging in how they reacted to that situation. I've always found it interesting that the Democrats used to complain about Governor Thompson's use of the line item veto, but then they were okay with it when Governor Doyle did almost the exact same thing. And to me, that's the type of stuff that's got to change, is if it's for me, it's for me kind of a mentality, and really bringing that approach. And I look forward to your great position to be able to do that, and certainly look forward you know, to those things continuing, because to most people and to school boards, we see that polarization and we feel like we're stuck in the middle sometimes. And so it's more of, I think, of a statement of what people perceive sometimes in Madison, and I think sometimes the parties themselves and the polarization kind of get in their way. And I think now having you in that leadership position is truly going to be a help and a blessing. So thank you. It's a big task for you, but certainly look forward to that.
Yes, well, I can count to 14, I can count to 19. I sort of know where the numbers are. But even just, I've had some good conversations on some things with Senator Fitzgerald, that we've sort of been able to temper some things, and he's been open to some suggestions from the minority party as we go into, you know, developing rules later this week that we have to vote on. And I too am sorry to see Senator Cullen leave. He was my seatmate in our caucus, and really we have big shoes to fill just in education within our caucus, because Senator John Layman, who's also on the education committee and a former teacher, was he has retired, and then with Senator Cullen, with his experience on school board, no longer being there. So we are developing, we were moving deeper into the bench in our caucus on education experts, and I appreciate Senator Vinehout stepping up with some rural education, and then our colleagues in Milwaukee also stepping up to fill those positions in the caucus.
And then my second comment, maybe somewhat critical, but I think one of the bigger impacts that I've seen lately to this community is the CapEx power and the Badger Cooley lines that are coming into this area. I think its impact on schools, it's slated to go over potential elementary, future middle school, its impacts on jobs, the tax base, the growth, all of those things is very concerning. The location of the substation itself is in question. That, you know, to me, the line having to double back on itself brings into question, why is the substation there? You know, the economic sense of the extra costs with that and all of those impacts, until you look at it and it seems that the location of that substation is serving to only a local utility that had lines in that area. And that obviously, you know, brings into question, how can those stated needs not be served 7 miles north so that the line does not have to double back on itself and have such an impact on this community? I know the decision is on the PSC, it's not a state legislative issue, but as someone elected to represent those of us, the areas, I noticed that you were not at the recent public hearing that the PSC had, and obviously I was concerned with that. You know, someone elected to represent this area, that's our chance. We all have a voice, and as someone elected, would like to, see that voice take maybe on a more active role, and would really like to know where you stand on the CapEx and Badger Cooley projects.
Sure. Well, Tim, and this has been an issue not just within the last 6 months, it's been years in the making.
Yeah, I
have attended many hearings and public meetings, if it was at the Village Hall in Cashton, if it was here in Holmen. I've been to many of them throughout the summer and fall. I think the hearing in question, I think it was a day I was in Madison, if that was the most recent one. So I was in Madison and unable to be there. That I have always said that we wanted to have more public opportunities rather than less, and I was pleased to see that the public commissioners were here in person, that we had sent that letter to Chairman Montgomery to be here, and I was glad to see that he was. I think as we have looked at this, certainly between the CapEx 2020 and Badger Cooley Crossing, I mean, I've had looked at both of these kind of ongoing utility and routing issues, siting issues, and certainly hope that there are ways that we can have the decision made that it follows existing right-of-ways, and there's sort of that northern route or kind of that southern route. I do think, looking where some of these utilities have been, I'm not the expert, but it seems like they could have doubled up on the lines or something like that, where you have these lines that are very close to one another. And, you know, in retrospect, I don't know. I mean, again, why the utilities weren't willing to do that. But I have put in public record, put my public opinion on it, concerned, asking questions and wanting to make sure that folks here had the opportunity to weigh in and asking about sort of the need for it and the route of it. And so I have made my opinions and my concern within the public record of the Public Service Commission.
It just seems the substation is very self-serving to a local utility and not to the community by having to double back.
Mm-hmm.
It just seems to make very little sense to me personally.
Okay. Anita?
I guess I'm going back to the Assembly Bill 1. And you may not know the answer to this, Jen, but I was just wondering how the authors of bills like these come up with the ideas when they must know, at least by now, that in general these are not great ideas. They're not supported by most people. I was just looking on the Journal Sentinel website as you were talking, Tim, and just the headlines about how there's almost no support for it, yet the hearing will go on tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. Do they, when they're developing these ideas, do they live in a cave? Do they not realize all the backlash? Is it even constitutionally legal for them to propose something under which public schools would no longer be public schools when students are entitled to a free public education? Is this, I mean, we're...
And constitutional questions are being at, you know, being raised about sort of circumventing the Department of Public Instruction and the superintendent, you know, Tony Evers, on some of these decisions. I read today on the Wheeler Report, they had an interview about Education Accountability Leads the 2015-2016 session, and it has a kind of a three-person interview of Representative Thiensfeld, Senator Farrell, or I guess four-person, Senator Olson, and Representative Sandy Pope about what is accountability, who should be held accountable, teachers, principals, administrators, what role should technology play in the classroom, and then sort of final thoughts. And it was really eye-opening to read this, and you can go to the Wheeler Report and find that about just sort of that conversation and where people are. I mean, accountability, I guess, is in the eye of the beholder as members are putting forward bills and proposals. Some have worked more inclusively with the education professionals than others. But I guess after the hearing on Wednesday, I mean, I think that they will get an earful of kind of criticisms, but they will also have those that support them. I mean, they are sort of listening to, you know, those who echo those same sentiments, that have some real concerns and want to defund public education in this state in order to, and I'm concerned about making it into more of a private effort that people can make money off of in educating our students.
Mm-hmm. What a shame. And I hope this is printed on the front page of every paper in Wisconsin. I think so many people are not aware that this is happening because it's come up so fast.
Well, I think vouchers, that program is still relatively new on a statewide sort of exposure. I think people in Milwaukee and Racine area, southeastern Wisconsin, are much more familiar with it. But I think now, in the last budget, as it was expanded and 500 students and then 1,000 students, and if the cap will be lifted, I think more and more people around the state who were not as familiar will be understanding sort of the breaking point that we are at right now in funding public education and the competition of these underperforming voucher schools and receiving taxpayer dollars that are not on the same sort of expectation and playing field of our public schools, but yet they receive taxpayer dollars that are very scarce at this point.
And this accountability bill being brought forward this fast, that there's a hearing in 2 days. So many people aren't even aware of it.
And they hope to have it passed this month in January in the assembly. So they hope to move very quickly.
Okay.
Tom,
did you have anything? Any questions?
You said about a committee. You said, are you on that committee?
On the education committee?
Yeah, there was some committee you mentioned. There are several different.
I would have an appointee onto the committee that is overseeing sort of the accountability. So yes, as the minority leader, if I'm not the minority leader, the minority leader would have an appointment.
Because that's part of the answer, maybe, to some of these accountability things, right? Isn't that why that committee is being formed? Because there is a certain percentage of voucher failures, right? Or is that why we're having that committee? Is that why it was formed?
Well, that is why Representative Thiensfeld, in seeing that schools are quote unquote failing, he would like to have this board be able to move very quickly to shut it down or move the public school into a charter school.
Is there a lot of voucher schools in the state? Do you know how many? I always hear about them, but I don't know how many there are.
Off the top of my head, I don't know how many there are.
Have you ever been to one of them?
I have not. They are heavily in, now we have Aquinas, I should backtrack. Aquinas is, they have students. I have been to Aquinas. I have toured, I've been to Aquinas. But as far as a Milwaukee public school or a Milwaukee voucher school, I have not been there. But they really have more prevalent down there. But now more schools are applying and have students and are receiving them. So I've been to Aquinas. And not all voucher schools are poor performing. I would say, Aquinas is a strong school, but just as we have really successful, voucher schools, we have ones that need improvement. We have public schools that are doing very well. We have ones that need improvement as well.
Kate hit on one thing I think is huge, is localism. I'm a big proponent of localism 101, but I kind of wonder if these voucher schools aren't as, they're pushing so much, or they're popular or they're not popular, or at least it's such a contentious item, because I think parents want choices, possibly. I don't think it's such an issue around here. I mean, my kids did Holmen and they did internet school, and I just think education on whole is a liquid river of opportunities. And Khan Academy, you hear all these different schools coming up, and I work in the community every day, and I always bring up education to my customers, and this is just for feedback for you. And I would say at least half of them say, oh yeah, we do some kind of online thing, are we doing this? For me, why I ran for the school board is to really think proactive and make sure we get out of our comfort zone a little bit, and how we can address the needs of our students.
And I support parents' choice to find a school that fits their student, their son and daughter, learning style. We have we have public charter schools. We have really a nice menu of choices here in Western Wisconsin for schools. The problem that I have is when then suddenly the taxpayer dollars are going to fund those schools, and that's where I have the problem. I support if a parent wants to send their child to a private parochial school, that is their choice. I don't have a problem with that. But now when we enter public taxpayer money into that equation, then we need to have transparency. Then we need to have accountability, and I think that they need to meet up with the same guidelines that our public schools are expected to.
Yeah, for looking at tax dollars, they should be held to the same standards. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. Thank you for coming.
Mm-hmm. Lisa?
I just had a question, Jen. What would you recommend for the common citizen parent? What should they do about this? What can they do about it? What would help kind of activate the voice of concerned parents that have heard some of the issues and ramifications of this rolling out so quickly without significant research and data mm-hmm. and thought?
Well,
what can parents do?
here we are at the with the school board members of Holmen, and it comes back to education. It comes back to educating those families, those parents. I think it comes back to having a conversation, you know, in our media with letters to the editor saying, did you know and what this will mean? I think it comes to educating the teachers so that they can have conversations with people in the community. And it does come back, like I said, this is something that's relatively new to us here in Western Wisconsin. And it talking about, and you know, you don't have to weigh in heavy, but I think presenting the facts because, you know, when you have a referendum out there, you can't say vote yes or vote no, but you have to be very careful about how you frame the issue, but you can put the facts out there and lay them out. And I think by laying those facts out to the community at large, I think that is important. When we have our hearings across the state, when we have our finance hearings, and I don't know where they will be. We typically have 4 to 6 of them, and they move around the state if there's something here in Western Wisconsin. You know, those are common themes that I tell people, you know, make sure you get some of the folks in your network to attend these hearings around the state so that committee of 16 hears a common theme of concerns. So I think that those are all areas that, you know, to be involved, be that squeaky wheel. And, you know, you're talking to you're preaching to the choir on this one, but looking regionally at some of our other colleagues that we can reach out to them who have indicated that you know, we've got strong schools here, strong public schools, and maybe they're a little, you know, a little soft on getting into the voucher program as fast and as hard as we have. And I think to say these are what the ramifications are to our public schools here in the region. So it's that education and kind of reaching out and finding the facts and presenting them to people. I know we all lead busy lives. You all lead busy lives. And to put one more thing on your plate or on the plate of working moms and dads who drive minivans and are worried about getting their kids to practice and music. And I mean, we all lead busy lives, but this is something that's really important that I think we are really at a critical juncture in our state when it comes to public education.
Well, and I think I have watched this voucher system grow, and from its very inception. And originally, the intent of it was to, under the guise of helping those, and I heard people say that, these poor children who are stuck in non-performing schools in Milwaukee, and how dare we not give them the opportunities that other students are getting. And yet what we're finding then, as the vouchers were expanded, and to Aquinas, I would challenge those voucher students in Aquinas to tell me that was Holmen really failing them? Was Onalaska really failing them, or Sparta, or any of the area schools that they came from to go, but yet they are getting voucher school money? 70% of the students who get voucher money were already yep. in a private school before they took advantage of the voucher money. So parents had already had the capacity and the ability to make those choices. So it just smells bad when they say that this was the reason we're expanding it, when the reality is we don't have the same issue that they have in Milwaukee. Milwaukee, as you said, is a whole different animal than what we have here, the things they have to overcome. I just find it telling that the people who are making bills or proposing bills on education are so far behind what's going on in education. And the example that I see is they're suggesting that we do letter grades for schools, A, B, C, D, and F. And schools are moving away. Yep. From letter grades. We're talking about standards. My granddaughter does not get a letter grade anymore. It's, has she met that expectation? And in Holmen, we have schools that would be getting C's right now because they are meeting expectation, and according to the budget or to the bill, that's what our letter grade would be in some of those schools. And I would beg to differ that we are C average school district. I believe that we are above average in all ways. And so it's just, to me, it's telling, I think, as you've said, that the people who are making these decisions, proposing these bills, are so far behind the ball that they don't understand what's happening in education to propose a bill like this about education. And I'm hoping, although what Tim's comments were about the power line, I saw so many people come out against it, but I have very little faith that it's, you know, gonna, the people are, will is gonna be had or be made, and I really worry about that hearing on Wednesday.
Mm-hmm.
Are people able to submit written comments to the committee? Is
yes.
that a possibility
yep.
in
they
case
can do
you
that
can't
well.
Travel? Because I would say, too, to parents, to school board members here that aren't able to make that meeting, that if they could submit written comments, I think it's really important that, and especially parents, they sometimes look at school board members with an agenda or whatever, protecting our power, but I think parents are the real people that should be heard from, because it will affect us. As we discuss things later this evening about finances and those sorts of things, it will have a negative impact on our district as we struggle to find enough finances in the current funding formula to do the things we need to do. So,
well, I think, I mean, the broader, you know, perspective of in the community, what does it mean when your school is assigned a letter grade of a C, you know, or a D, and you're identified that you've got 3 or 4 years you're on probation to improve it. If I was a real estate person, if I was a realtor, do you know how hard it is to sell a home in a C identified school district? I mean, that's what the first thing is families ask about is, what are the schools, what are they like, how strong are they, what are the, you know, options and opportunities that we have, and to assign this, you know, sort of scarlet letter then to these schools, that's not going to be healthy for a robust home sale economy. I mean, it just sort of, it's that stone into the pond with many, many ripples about how it affects you. And when you kind of start to think down into the weeds about what this means to our community to have a school assigned a grade, what that means for, you know, small business, you know, startup and creative people, the creative economy and young people to come and buy homes and grow their families and things like that. That's, like you mentioned, the schools are moving away from those letter grades.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, and I know you probably have more comments and questions, but I think time is proceeding, and we really do need to move on our agenda. But thank you so very much for being here, being willing to answer difficult questions at some times, and then your leadership very much appreciated. So.
Well, thank you. And I have hired an additional district person. Her name is Taylor Goodine, so she will be my district person. I will be opening up a district office in the near future. So kind of Senator Rood had a district office, Senator Kopanky had a district office for a time. So with my new role and responsibility doing that, and encourage you, if you haven't, to join and, or sign up on my e-newsletter. So with today's technology, it's really easy to keep in touch with people. And so every 2 weeks, my office sends out an e-newsletter with district happenings, bills that are introduced in Madison, things that are happening in Madison, things that are happening back in the district. So I appreciate that two-way communication, kind of that mutual responsibility that we have as elected officials and representing our constituents. So thank you.
You should do a kudos to your staff, too. They always are very responsive to our questions and concerns.
Oh.
Make
good.
Sure you
thank
share
you. I will pass that along okay. when I see them tomorrow.
Are you thank driving you. Back tonight?
I am going to Madison tomorrow morning early, but I pack tonight, and let's see, the kids are getting ready. They should have their pajamas on, and we're doing our heart words with our kindergartner right now with Zach, and Nate should be reading for 20 minutes. So.
Okay, yeah, exactly. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Much
thank
appreciated.
You,
please tell Chris thank
oh,
you for
thank
all
you.
He does.
Well, as we have, we quickly know that in this role and as elected officials, it's you feel like the public has ownership and your family has visitation rights. So I'm going to go home and visit with them for a little bit.
Thank you, Jen.
The last comment, I've read a story about your family in Illinois, and I admire you for what you've been through. It's not easy.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Then moving on, reports and discussion, bus van purchase. Beth Hobbs.
Hello.
Welcome, Beth.
I sent out an issue paper that I'm going to be looking at purchasing two buses. They'll come up for bid on the 20th is when I would have bid opening. I don't have any bids yet to share with you yet. I'm looking that they're not going to waver too much from last year, which was pretty close to the $89,000 mark for 77 passenger buses. I had to delay this a little bit because I had put in for a clean diesel rebate program that the EPA puts out. They didn't give me my letter of denial on Thursday, so I did not get any rebates I would have gotten $20,000 per bus, so I had put three buses down, so I could have eliminated three buses from the fleet and then replaced with one bus, but that would have gotten, they're trying to get rid of the old buses that have the bad diesel emissions. So that was disappointing because they have lots and lots and lots of money and they could have gave me a little bit. So that's what I have. So when I come back on the 26th, I'll have the prices and everything for those.
Okay. Any questions?
I just real quickly, I think this is your first time coming to the board with bus purchases.
Oh, I did last year.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I forgot that. I said I was just going to give you a bad time and ask lots of hard questions. But I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to say thank you. I know how difficult it is keeping that fleet going during these cold winter months. So thank you for everything you're doing there.
Thank you.
Dr. Carlson sent me a note that our State Patrol lady that inspects our buses every year that's been with me since I've been here, 20 years, she's retiring this year, and mm-hmm. she's dearly missed because she's a sweetheart, and she's very good to us.
Thank you.
For all you do. Then anticipated spaces for new open enrollment. Julie Krakow.
Helps if you know the password. Okay, so each year we are required to determine the number of spaces for new open enrollment requests into the district. And inside your packet tonight you have a chart that looks like this. I apologize, it's kind of hard to read on the screen up there. So on this chart on the far left, you're going to see each of our grade levels. In the second column, you see the reported number of students attending our schools this year. So these numbers reflect our reported enrollment from third Friday in September. Your third column there includes the current versus, actually it's the fourth column, the current versus a projected number of sections at the elementary level. And then I've also included our current district class size guidelines for us to see. Using the projected enrollment number for each elementary grade level and maximizing the number of students per section according to our current district class size guideline, the anticipated number of elementary sections could possibly increase by 3. At the far right, you'll see the number of anticipated new spaces available for open enrollment requests. You will notice that grade 5, for example, shows just one available space. This really doesn't mean that we will accept just one new open enrollment request at grade 5, but it does mean that if there's more than one request, it could result in an additional section at grade 5. At the elementary level, while a request might be approved for open enrollment into the district, requests for specific schools are considered separately. At 4K middle school and high school, the number of slots available is open. We will consider all open enroll requests. New approved requests then could result in increase in sections or overall staffing at 4K middle school and high school. Special ed students who might need a self-contained program at elementary or high school levels could be denied because we have no self-contained programming at those levels. And just a reminder that at 4K, two sections equal one FTE, and at the kindergarten level, one section equals one FTE. Most important to note is that the calculation used here to determine open enrollment capacity differs from the calculation that we use to determine the number of sections per grade level at specific buildings. This may result in different projected total numbers of sections. Again, the intent is for the district to consider all requests for open enrollment and to place our students appropriately. I'm willing to take any questions you might have.
I'm just going to add a couple clarifying comments. Again, by statute, we are required to do this, especially if down the road we do end up denying requests. Then, if we do that, we must show that the Board of Education took action on establishing max capacities. But at this point, as Mrs. Krakow has mentioned and emphasized, we have not had a practice of saying no at all. And until the board would give some specific direction as to that, we will continue accepting those requests, with the exception, as Julie mentioned, we have not accepted at times specific requests for specific elementary schools. So
those would be just self-contained special education programs, and there really aren't many schools that have them.
So we are open. That's our process. We view that, and so now, yeah. If there's any questions,
Is there some? I don't know if it was court cases that were taking place related to open enrollment and special needs students, and was that related to the self-contained classrooms or?
No, I believe there was a reason that you could deny open enrollment based on cost, and some districts were not able to prove that cost was so excessive that they couldn't handle that student coming in. I think we will see some new wording in our statute which will eliminate some of that cost, the cost estimates that we use between districts. We will no longer be able to deny because of cost.
So do we get 100% reimbursement for special needs students from the state, or is it less than? Because isn't categorized aid different, isn't for special needs or?
When children open enroll into our district, mm-hmm. we estimate their cost back to their home district. And the home district, and we agree that that's a reasonable cost they pay us for their student here. Same as when our students go elsewhere. They tell us what it will cost, and we have an agreement between the two districts. We all receive the same amount of tuition for all open enrolled kids, whether they're special ed or not special ed.
Thank you very much, Julie. Mm-hmm. And this will be on the agenda at the next meeting, January 26th.
Correct.
Okay, then health insurance options. Mr. Clark.
Good evening. I've also asked Janice Wavra, our representative from the Insurance Center, to join me. The slides that we'll present tonight are somewhat familiar. The first slide talks about a potential timeline for health insurance renewal. Remember, our start of our new plan year is July 1st, and if we were to look at a status quo option, we would receive quotes on May 1st, bring the quotes to the board for first reading and the second, and then communicate to staff. We believe that with the 5% budget input variable for health insurance, a 5% increase, that we need to do a little bit more than this. We do not want to. I call this the reactive approach to our health insurance renewal, and I think we want to take a proactive approach to our health insurance renewal so that we don't get to the point where we receive the quotes and find out we're delivered something more than 5% and have no options to exercise. And so the proactive approach is the next slide I would share, and this gets a little bit more busy because it requires a lot of work to be done in advance, but I believe work that's well worth it to not be caught without any options. So we are here tonight reporting to the board in this timeline. That's the second event. We've already met with the Personnel and Governance Committee. We, in fact, also did a report to the Finance Committee on the results of the changes made to the health insurance plan last year. We would be evaluating claims information, which is not available to us yet. Correct, Janice?
That is correct.
But we expect to be available here this month. Claims experience is a large determining factor in what our health insurance premium increases will be for next year. We'll complete an administrative review of that information and look at options on plan design changes that could be considered based upon that utilization information. And we indicate on this timeline present options too, but there's no one there. We have left that open. We believe that if there's large-scale changes, it may be most appropriate to bring those back to the board. If, on the other hand, the claims information we have suggests smaller insurance increases, we may feel more comfortable presenting that to the Personnel and Governance Committee. And if no changes at all, then, so we've not indicated to whom, but left that blank depending upon the work that Janice and I do in the upcoming month. And then again, approved options by blank. And again, that depends upon the types of changes we would develop and the significance of those changes. After that, it really remains the same. We would look to receive quotes, bring those quotes to the board, seek board approval, and make sure that we're communicating with staff throughout that process. To give you an idea where we have been, we put together this chart. This shows the 12-13 plan design that we had, including some of the major plan components such as deductibles and coinsurance and maximum out-of-pockets. It in 2013-14 shows where we introduced some HRA benefits to employees at the same time that such things as deductibles were increasing. It shows in 14-15, this last plan year, how we added a second plan, a plan number two option to our employees, which in fact approximately 80% of our employees chose. They view that as a favorable option. So that's where we've been in terms of our evolution for health insurance. You can see things like in the plan two option, coinsurance for out-of-network services increasing, deductibles increasing $1,000 for a family plan. So we've been making this move, as you know, towards a more consumer-driven health insurance model where employees, as they say, have a skin in the game. That is, when you make a health care decision, it also includes some financial implications for the employee and also a good dose of wellness. That is, we want to encourage, incentivize our employees to pursue wellness so that they can avoid those things that are avoidable in terms of health insurance care or health care. Not all things are avoidable, and that's why we need to have insurance. So if that's where we've been, let me describe to you, we've talked some time about having a plan that looks not only at 1 year, but multiple years out in the future. You can see here for 15-16, plan one design would be maintained as a status quo plan. And then I have plan two evolving into potentially a 2A, that'd be the status quo. Now I have or plan 2B, which based upon utilization-driven changes might look at things like increasing the deductibles and increasing maximum out-of-pockets. To offset the direct impact to employees, you can also see in yellow, we would look at increasing the HRA benefit. So trying to mitigate some of that deductible increase by increasing HRAs. This is a potential, this is a look for you at something that might be a plan design that we develop based upon claims experience information. Then moving on to the next year, if we've not adopted plan 2B in the 15-16 cycle, I believe we should be prepared to look at it or something like it as our next evolution in the 2016-17 cycle. And then in the 2016-17 cycle, have a new plan called, in this example, Plan 3, which actually takes us to a dual offering, Plan 3, being something that we looked at 2 years ago. When we came to you with an original three-year model at what it would look like 3 years from now, that's it. That is the same model we talked about at that point in time. Now, one thing you will note here is Plan 1 is gone. The reason Plan 1 is illustrated as gone in this model can be described in that box at the bottom of the page. We believe that when less than 10% of the enrolled employees elect a plan, the plan should be phased out and replaced with another option. If we're not below 10% at that point in time, we would look to not eliminate the plan. So this is a fluid model, but it's a model to help the board understand where administration is recommending we're going and to help employees understand where we're going. As I said, it remains flexible, but it gives an overall direction. Again, focusing on consumerism, focusing on wellness and incentives towards wellness. You'll also notice in the introduction of Plan 3 that we are transitioning from an HRA type plan contribution to an HSA plan contribution. And HSA plan contributions have some additional advantages for employees in terms of portability. I don't have the complete list, but it's a better option for employees. And so we believe as a part of introducing the Plan 3 deductibles, we should do some things to, again, mitigate the offset the increases by moving towards an HSA plan. And that plan design, Plan 3, is actually quite comparable, Janice would tell you, to the health insurance plans being offered by many of the area school districts. So we still remain very competitive in terms of the benefits that we're offering to employees. That one note on the bottom, I want to read through that too. Proposals may be accepted from carriers other than WCA to ensure competitive pricing of premiums and quality of service. So we've been for a couple of years here now with the WCA as our carrier, and we feel that there might be reason, if not this year, next year, to accept proposals from other carriers. And wanted to put that out there so that there'd be no surprises if we got to that point in May, and we wouldn't want that to be the first time that that was introduced. Janice, what did I miss?
Nothing. You did a great job. Very thorough.
No questions.
Yeah, just a quick question. I'm just curious. I worked with the insurance center before. I know you're a great company. Why did you choose her? Why did you choose the insurance center? Why not some other insurance company? I'm just curious.
Several years ago, the administrative team and some groups that even when their collective bargaining was fully in place wanted to venture out and do some things in terms of health insurance. We reviewed various agencies and found that they were really willing to do the types of things that we needed them to do to make those changes. After they got a foot in the door and proved themselves with the administrative and secretarial group, they became trusted. And then when the teachers wanted to do some things, they already knew Janice in the insurance center.
I'm just curious.
And Janice served them well. So they keep earning, by their relationships with employees, they keep earning more and more trust and confidence in what they do. And so that's why we have Janice sitting here.
And she gave you all these numbers, right? She helps feed those information to you?
She helps us. Janice doesn't steer our direction, though. I think she spends a lot of time trying to figure out what we want to do, what's best for our employees, what's best for us fiscally in this district, and then tries to help us understand what options are available to reach our goals.
It's just my background. I'm just curious. I'm still the greenhorn on the crew here. Really pretty graphs. You make great graphs.
Are there any other questions? So I do. I just some clarifications as we're moving forward. The HRA is for coinsurance, correct?
Correct. We have two HRAs currently in place. So one HRA is available to employees, and when they incur coinsurance expenses, they can apply those HRA dollars to cover those coinsurance expenses. The other HRA we have is a wellness incentive, and employees receive those HRA dollars by achieving certain wellness benchmarks. Those HRA dollars can be used for all forms of medical related expenses, not just for coinsurance.
So it could be used for deductible?
Absolutely.
Okay, because that was my question with the change that we're looking at and Plan 2B. We're increasing the deductible. The coinsurance is staying the same, yet where we're giving more dollars is in the coinsurance HRA.
Good point.
Which isn't being affected where the out-of-pocket for the deductible. So that would be just something to think about. I think it will impact them in the deductible one. So if we could maybe steer the dollars toward that one instead of, it's just, I was just wondering.
Yeah, no, that's a fair point, because if you look at the Plan 3 design, we're looking at going to in 2016-17, notice the coinsurance qualifier is removed.
Right, mm-hmm. I did notice.
And what we're actually doing at that point in time is trying to move towards that. Yeah. What you're suggesting is maybe we look at doing that earlier or make some incremental step towards that mm-hmm. earlier. So thank you for those comments.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. I know we're trying to get a little bit ahead of schedule so that as we move forward, then the information can be shared with our staff and stakeholders sooner. So thank you very much.
Thanks for coming.
Janice, 40th class reunion this year, you know, 40 years ago.
Thanks a lot.
Well, me too. Okay. Janice was a DeSoto graduate. Competitor of mine when we were in high school 40 years ago. So then, moving on to potential referendum questions, Dr. Carlson.
Thank you. Well, Mr. Clark and I, we don't plan to be up here long. It's just depending on what you need. But we do want to just share a couple items that are pretty fresh being presented to you this evening. By the way, thank you for your work Thursday night. So we have included in your board packet follow-up to questions and things that came up Thursday night. And again, to acknowledge the fact that we've been working on these, you just received today. So the intent would be for you to review at your earliest convenience and then forward, communicate any questions that you have to us, certainly within the coming 2 weeks. Leading up to January 26th. There you have this document in your board packet, and this is what I'm talking about. When you can, it would be appreciative if you go through those and let us know if there are follow-up from that we can help with. Also in your board packet, let me just see here. Also, we've included some draft resolutions. We've been, as we have shared with you now for the last month plus, we've been working with legal counsel to help us with potential language if the board would consider moving forward to a referendum. And so we thought we can't necessarily wait until the 26th. We have to do some of this work in advance, even before you make that decision, just so we are preparing and moving this forward. Not only that, but you need something to consider action on January 26th. So this is a beginning draft for you. We are still working with legal counsel. In fact, there's a phone conference tomorrow, follow-up. And so this is why we have draft on there, but we thought we would want to get something in front of you. So we have this draft. This would be referendum question one. And again, this focuses on the technology piece, which would be a non-recurring question as far as funding beyond the, exceeding the revenue cap. And then we've also included a draft of the second question, which would be the focus on the facility maintenance and the fleet replacement cycle for transportation. So these are what we have put in very recently. Again, working on these, continue to work on these, but that's what's presented, and we would be happy to either here or after we leave tonight, address any ongoing follow-up questions that you may have leading up to Again, if you do determine to put it on the board agenda for the 26th, consider an action on advancing questions in the form of a referendum to the April election. So that's what we had prepared for this evening.
Okay, any questions or comments related to the referendum issues, questions? I know I did have a call, and I think I did share that with Dr. Carlson after our meeting regarding the ongoing, and we've had that question every time we've done, even with a building, and then we've done the maintenance, the operational as an ongoing. And maybe, would one of you maybe just respond to that issue? Why is it ongoing instead of a date certain type of question?
With greater level of certainty, we are confident and feel that expenses and costs related to continuing to care for our facilities is something that we feel confident that will continue beyond 4 years. And so that we would not be advancing that if we didn't believe that. Again, those costs will continue to be there, as well as transportation. We have an outstanding transportation department. Our community has long time supported transporting our students in the fashion that we do. We have known to give a quality service out to our parents and guardians. And so we believe that as long as our community wants us to provide that service, those costs are going to continue beyond 4 years and ongoing. And so that's what separates some of that than perhaps what we are advancing as a recommendation on the non-recurring portion as far as technology. Jay?
Two other points that give us confidence to bring these forward is the wording. We've been very specific in the wording of this, so the public can rest assured that the dollars they would approve in question two, should the board choose to advance it, would be used exclusively for the purposes stated. The second item is that if at any point in the future those dollars should not be needed, we don't foresee that, but if they should not be needed, the board has the authority to rescind that. And so it wouldn't be as though we'd continue to levy those dollars even though we don't have a purpose for them. The board would have the authority to rescind. So there are some measures in place, even though they be ongoing, to make sure they're used for the purpose intended.
Could I just ask, I actually was contacted about the technology dollars and why they would not be an ongoing expense since technology is exploding. It's not going away. It's only going to get more expensive. Can you explain why that would not be an ongoing expense?
Sure. I'll give it a try. With the technology, we have a very good idea of today and even as far out as 4 years. We're less unsure of what that might look like. We have been very upfront and open that technology is here to stay with us. But when it gets to the point of looking out as far as 4 years, what does that look like? And then what's the related cost to that? We're more unsure than certainly with facility maintenance and fleet replacement. But we've also said it is very likely that those costs or comparable costs will continue. And so it's very possible the board would need to entertain the idea of going back to the community in 4 years. But we're not at the point that we can really describe for sure what that looks like.
Anything else? Okay. Thank you very much, then. I think we will move on to the consent agenda items. We only have three this evening: the personnel report, financial claims and accounts, and the school year calendar. So unless a board member would like to ask for one to be pulled for discussion, I would entertain a motion to approve the items on the consent agenda as presented.
So moved.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all of those in favor of approving the consent agenda items as presented, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries.
Sorry.
Board member reports and discussions. I'll call on board members in order of roll call. I'd ask for you to present any comments or committee reports that you have. Mr. Menninger.
Just a couple of things this evening. First off, the Buildings and Grounds Committee met earlier tonight. We are relatively caught up on our policy work, so it was a fairly short meeting tonight. One of the items, basically most of the items, was around just looking at the possibility, and I know that comes up from time to time, of air conditioning in the gymnasium. So something that is being talked about at the Buildings and Grounds Committee. And I know that does come up from time to time. The other comment I had tonight was a little bit more of an analogy that I just wanted to share with the board this evening. Recently, and particularly before the last election, there was a lot of discussion around the voter ID bill and a lot of debate around this bill at that time. There were some wonderful sound bites around that, around how it was there to prevent fraud, how it was there to keep the integrity in the system, almost the implication that if you weren't against it, that you were opposed to those type of things. But to me, that was a solution looking for a problem that did not exist, because I don't think there is widespread fraud, and I certainly feel that it had the ability of voter suppression. I share that analogy because recently at the board has had quite a bit of discussion, or a little bit of discussion, around how board members may request information from administration. The sound bites on it sound wonderful. We're one board needing to act as one body, and that we certainly don't want to have a lot of frivolous waste of time for board members, and certainly, sounds good on the surface. But I also think that is a solution looking for a problem, because I don't think that we've had a lot of that. The other concern is that by having that process that allows a majority of the board to decide what information is and is not shared, and could allow for potential information to be either withheld or to be not disseminated based on the whims of a majority of the board members. And so I would just want to caution that I know that has not come up for any board action, but would certainly want to continue to caution the board as that is being discussed, to just take a look at that, and again, some unintended consequences, and certainly maybe not this board, but future boards could certainly use that in a negative fashion.
Thank you. Lisa Collins.
I do not have anything to add today.
Okay. Gary Dunlap.
I'd like to thank Senator Schilling for visiting us. It's always nice to hear what she has to say. And as Tim said, we did discuss the cooling of the gymnasium, and it certainly isn't something we're going to put into the budget, but we're going to try to see if we can come up with some numbers, because there was some interest in the public on getting some numbers together again, and that's why that's heading down that road. And we did find out tonight that there's plenty of cooling capacity. We have 90 tons of extra cooling capacity to cool the gymnasium and entire high school with the new technology out there for moving things around. So that was encouraging. So there'll be news coming your way.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Cruz, Tom Cruz.
I'd like to thank Jennifer Schilling for coming. It was nice that she gave us a little bit of update. I do think she does a good job keeping us all in the loop of things. And I know in the past, when I've in business environments with Yes Holmen and stuff with the gymnasium, that would be, I know it's really busy in the gymnasium. Really booked up, isn't it? A lot of times, there's a lot of things going on. I think that's a good sign. I'm all in favor of AC.
Okay, thank you, Alex Zachary.
When it comes to the cooling of the gym, we usually in gym class, we just open the door and have a fan. I guess it's never really crossed my mind to have AC in the gym, but I would encourage that idea. Nothing to report from the school. At the concession stand, we had a boy pay for the next person's popcorn. Oh. And then that continued up till 21 people. Wow. Including Mr. Gary Dunlap and Mr. Bob Bear in the back. So I'd like to thank them for helping us do that.
Cool. Thank you for sharing that.
I have a real quick comment.
Yes, Tom.
I just wanted to encourage everyone to go to that that band event this weekend. And when you get the brochure for it, there might be a company in there you might want to patronize, but anyway.
Okay. Anita Jagosinski.
I just wanted to thank Senator Schilling for coming and hopefully opening the eyes of the board and anyone in the public who's listening to her tonight about what's happening in Madison, because it's coming up really fast, like everything seems to in Madison, and it'll affect your kids, their education. And really, some things that happen in Madison, you don't realize for years, because it's such a, it kind of leaches out. It happens in a small area, and then it kind of, it's a ripple effect that's not felt for a while. So pay attention, contact your legislators, let them know how you feel. Read the paper, read the headlines, read the Wheeler Report. Look on that every day. It's an update of what's happening at the Capitol and the news all around the state. It's a really good source, and it's nonpartisan, so take a look at that. And I also just wanted to follow up to Tim's comment about board requests for information and data and things like that. My feeling is that we have retreats where we get together as a board, and we try to work together and develop processes by which we will act as a board. And one of the things we worked on the last time was data requests and what frivolous data requests were and what they weren't. And Tim was not at that data retreat, but we worked on that data request and how those would be handled. So I just wanted to bring that up.
Hey, Kate Mayer.
Yes, to everything that everyone has said, thank you to Jen. I so appreciate her support of public education. Not everyone's senator across the state is such an advocate as she is. I think she would do anything for the students of our of her district, and I so appreciate that. Follow up to a little bit with what you just said, Anita and Tim. Yes, we do have a majority and a minority, but I am not a majority honoring whims. I study what I do. I go into committee meetings. Just a caution about a word like that. What I vote for is not a whim. And when you ask for data, I can honor that. That's fine. I would never call that a whim. We can agree to disagree. I have my norms in front of me all the time, and I want to make sure I respect everyone. And I work really hard to do that. So that's it. SALC is meeting soon, and working toward, we're talking about class size and what we're doing about that and trying to do it in the best way possible for our district, both financially and philosophically. You know, it's a big thing, but I think we're really close to coming to a point where we'll come with a recommendation.
Okay, thank you, Kate.
You're welcome.
I would just mention that the compensation model meeting was canceled last week because of the school closure, so we did not hold that, and personnel and governance will be meeting on Wednesday, and we have a couple items that we will be taking up, and I think that's all I have for this evening. I would note that the red file is going through. I haven't had a chance to look at it with correspondence. Board meeting schedule, the 21st, next week, the 21st to the 23rd, is the State Education Convention in Milwaukee. And I know a good number of us are going. Lisa, Tom, myself, Anita, and Kate. And appreciate your taking time out of your busy schedules to make that happen and to attend, because I think we all, one of our learner goals in the school district of Holmen is lifelong learning, and I think by attending these sorts of things we are modeling what our goal is to our students. And so I hope that one day we're going to get 100% participation. In some schools
do,
I know they
really
do
cool.
It's very cool. So yeah. But 5 out of 7, that is progress, so that's a great thing. We, on February 9th is a school board meeting, I'm sorry, January 26th and February 9th is a school board meeting, and then we meet with Matt Fail on February 17th. School board verification of candidacy and ballot order. I know that Anita and Kate are the only candidates, but we do need to draw for the order on the ballot.
It
so.
Better be me first, Anita.
So who wants to draw?
Gary wants
to draw.
Let
me draw.
So the first person on the ballot will be...
Yes, 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 yes.
you're competitive.
Kate Mayer.
So the second person then would be Anita. Thank you.
Good luck.
Then WASB resolutions, a number of resolutions. So as we had our state senator here this evening, the WASB resolutions are used to guide the School Board Association as they work with our legislators and give them direction. And I'm sure with the bill number one, Assembly Bill number one coming out, there's going to be a lot of discussion and activity. Who is our representative? Is it Lisa? Mm-hmm. Are you our delegate?
That was the last.
So would you, anything that you see in those resolutions, we've been given copies of them, contacts. I know we encourage people to look at them. If there's anything that you see that you would like to have some discussion on, now would be the time to do that. Otherwise, what we've done in the past is always just left it up to our representative to vote as they felt would be in the best position for the school district, for the school district of Holmen to represent us. So,
no, and I brought my notes because I'm on that committee.
Committee, yep.
Yeah, so if there are questions or if you wanted, if any of you wanted to email me or whatever as to why something was approved and why it wasn't and what the thought.
Sure. Let Lisa know so that she can vote then that if they have any questions or concerns. So. Okay, then the next item is district administrator search process. And this is on the agenda this evening because on Wednesday we will be looking at, in personnel and governance, the plan is to present to them for a recommendation to the board, a process. But I wanted to put this on here so that we had a little bit of time to, as a board, to maybe address any thoughts or philosophies or questions, really following the same process that had been used in the past. We did use a third party group. It was a school board association. But in what the recommendation and what we're going to discuss on Wednesday is we now contract with an organization that knows our school district's values, that helps us as we do screening of applicants, especially high-level applicants. They do some initial screening for us. But they would be, because of their history with the school district, have the background on us already, could hit the ground running. And they've been here since they've been involved with the school district since I've been in, so prior to that, I think many, many years with the school district. They would come out and engage stakeholders doing maybe, I don't know if it'd be a focus group or some type of interview or have some communications with folks about what is it that we're looking for, they're looking for as a district administrator. And then certainly as a board, they would look to us to provide that input as well. And then we've worked initially with Melissa. She's provided a good timeline for us. We've got a lot of things on the horizon this year. So we want to make sure that we are not lost in the pool of people that are school districts that are looking for district administrators. I understand there are about 30 is what I've heard. So that's why we have done the initial posting. They've did it just a basic posting so that the word is out there that we are looking for a district administrator and using the current practice that we use to establish those postings. But we can always add to those. We can wordsmith or whatever if we want to make some changes. And then initially, we would also look at when we get down to the finalists, what does that look like? What will we do similar where we have stakeholder interviews, school board interviews, and then narrowing it down? Do we want to bring in 10 and do something quick and then narrow it down, or do we just want to go to the finalists? And a lot of that sometimes depends on the pool. So taking that kind of feedback to the Personnel and Governance Committee, and then would be bringing back a recommendation on January 26th, just maybe more formalized. But I just wanted, if you have had some thoughts since early December on this, would love to hear them as far as the process that we use. So any thoughts? You can share them here, you can share them.
Process of choosing an applicant, you mean?
Well, choosing
Or the process you have, how you filter the applicants out.
How we fill the position.
Okay. Lisa? I obviously like the concept of you know, the applicant being able to meet the staff that are directly, you know, working with the administrator or whoever the hired, newly hired staff would be. I mean, even if it isn't directly under, it would be, if it could be teachers, it could be everyone come to the table and be able to just ask questions if they had questions. I know there's standard questions that typically are asked during a formal interview process, but then to be able to have an opportunity to ask other questions that might be more specific.
So something like we kind of have done a townhouse kind of thing where the finalist has done a presentation to whomever. It's been an open forum. The group that we would be looking at, the group that we utilize, would then help to make sure that appropriate questions were asked. And then anybody who was in attendance could provide a paper input, their thoughts, their reaction to each candidate. And that was used when we were in the finalist mode, the two finalists, I think. Mm-hmm. But we also did have an opportunity for the leadership team to meet with the candidates as well, the finalists as well, and provide, again, input. Keep in mind, as a board of directors, that final decision is ours, and we can ask for input. You know, it's when you seek that input, you're going to get a lot of good input, but you may see something, you may feel something different than what, you know, the masses have provided. So the bottom line is we are assigned to make that decision. It's one of the key things that we do is hiring of that district administrator.
I really like those scenario kinds of questions. I mean, I know it's hard to duplicate what a person would actually be like in the job, but those scenario kinds of questions where there's challenging, you know, there's challenging situations that we have to deal with in a school district, and how, you know, how have you handled a thing like this, or how, you know, those kinds of questions are really cool to hear how each individual candidate can think on their toes or bring forth their history with that.
Sure.
I don't know the past, what you've done with that, but it'd be my request that a student be on this board for finding a new superintendent, along with teacher representation. I think it's very easy to sometimes overlook that, but these are people that are going to deal with, or not deal with, but, you know, associate with that person on a daily basis. So.
Well, students have been included, will be included. Okay. Wouldn't necessarily be included in the Board of Education, though, decision level. Mm-hmm. So, but that would, it's something good to talk about, Alex. So. Other things?
We discussed about restricting the applicants to current superintendents. Is that still on the table, or is that?
I think it is. I think that would be something we would have, this group would like seek out input from us. What are we looking for in a superintendent? What would we like to see? So Gary, I've actually carried that along. That comment has been made before, and so I've carried that along, but I didn't want to do anything with it yet, because we need to have that full discussion, I think, with the group. So.
Just a couple of quick comments. I really like the scenario questions. Mm-hmm. I think those are very good, because you can certainly draw out reactions and that. The other thing is I also, I think the more people involved, the better. But then I think we also need to make some arrangements to just make sure everybody involved in the process understands what they can and cannot ask in interviews.
Right, yep. I know.
Did you bring that up, Tim? Did you bring that up?
Questions.
Remember, in that the group, yeah,
questions that, yeah, we asked, each person was able to ask. Mm-hmm. They were pre-written, and we each presented
that questions. Questions.
We actually, and yes, we, and I suspect that any group we work with would also do that, present to us the questions that we would like to have asked. It's sometimes in those outside groups, and not that the leadership team would do something erroneous, because the HR people are in there, but it's the non-formal kind of, or when you do the town hall kind of thing and someone in the back might raise a hand. That's why having those HR professionals, contractors that we would be working with, they would be able to say, thank you for your question, but it's really not appropriate.
Spontaneity is important too.
Yeah. Good.
Can I make one more comment on
yes,
that?
Yes, Lisa.
When the questions are formulated, and then it sounds like there will be a process.
Opportunity for us to have input, yes.
Right. The leadership qualities, I think, are huge, to capitalize on leadership qualities. Mm-hmm. and how to get to those qualities through the questions are huge, I think. So if this contracted agency is probably experts at that.
Yeah, and like I said, they have, you know, they know our values. They know the values of the school district, and so they know what we are looking for in every other position. So I, you know, Jay is shaking his head. I would hope that they would know what we would be looking for in a district administrator. But that's why we would ask them to come out and talk to us or do a conference call and have them talk with us. They ask some, the questioning that they do is very student-driven. They want to make sure that when they're doing teachers, they want to make sure that it's about students and, you know, educating our students. And on each level, it addresses the position that we're interviewing for. So, okay, good. So we will share some of that with the Personnel and Governance Committee, and then you'll see a recommendation. I'll try to make sure that it's shared with you. We would like to get approval, consensus of the board on the 26th to move forward with this group. We do have some information from the School Board Association, as well as a little bit of information from an outside source. But as I met with the leadership in our HR department, it just made sense for us to work with someone who has 20 years of experience with the school district. And we often talk about the quality staff that we have here, and they play a role in that success. So, good. Then the last thing is the board meeting reflections. Any comments? I think the board meeting went very well tonight. It's almost 9, but it is nice to see Jennifer. That was almost 40 minutes of our time, and so that's critical issues, though, that are being addressed, and it's nice to have her and Representative Doyle come. So they don't always, across the state, they don't always attend school board meetings. So then executive session. Kate, if you would read the executive session.
Yes. Be it resolved that the Board of Education moves to executive session as per Wisconsin Statutes 19.851C for the purpose of considering, reviewing the district administrator's performance evaluation.
Is there a second?
Second.
And the roll call, Kate?
Yes, ma'am. Tim Menninger.
Yes.
Lisa Collins.
Yes.
Gary Dunlap. Tom Cruise.
Yes.
Cheryl Hancock.
Yes.
Anita Jakosinski.
Yes.
Kate Mayer. Yes.
Okay, we will go in like a 5-minute break.
Okay.